Good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure in welcoming you all for the IPLA Indust Webmaster Series. We are verging towards the end of all series. We have entered into webinar 27. Today, we have three eminent speakers, Dr. Kanika Kapoor, Dr. Pankaj Mansali, and Dr. Chandra Mauleshwari. We are going to talk all about renal biopsy and histopathology of renal biopsy. So the moderator of the day is Dr. Pankaj Mansali. Dr. Pankaj Bansali is a pediatric nephrologist qualified from Mumbai, and he has done his fellowship in pediatric nephrology from Wadia Hospital, Mumbai and St. John's Medical College, Bangalore. He's associated with many hospitals like Orchard Pediatric Super Specialty Clinic, MGM Medical College and many other hospitals. Over to Dr. Pankaj Hari to moderate the session. And a small thing, like you can drop your questions in the question answer section so that we'll take up the questions verbally towards the end of the session. Over to Dr. Pankaj.
Thank you, ma'am. Yeah, I hope I'm visible, audible, and slide is also clear.
Yeah, yeah, all fine, yeah. All good.
So thank you, Dr. Kalyani, ma'am, for giving us opportunity to be in this such a wonderful platform. Today we'll start with kidney biopsy. Now, what we all nephrologists, we are very versed with kidney biopsy. But can we imagine that we have to manage chronic glomerulonephritis only looking at urine report? There was no nephrology without histopathology of the kidney. Or even if we plan to do biopsy, we have to resort to kidney biopsy. I think it is almost unimaginable for all of us. But this was era some 60 to 70 years back, where nephrology was more of a syndromic approach, where we have different syndromes like clinic acute nephritis, nephrosis, hematuria, or chronic kidney failure. But there was no clear, distinct pathological process. So everything was remaining obscure. And nobody was aware that one clinical syndrome can have multiple pathologies, or one pathology can have different manifestations, which we are now quite clear. So even if it is there is an asymptomatic hematuria, it can be secondary to a lot of say other pathologies. Only one pathology is not behind this presentation. And same way, if we consider C3 glomerulopathy, it can have different manifestations also. But that time it was not clear. Now, nephrology and renal pathology are so interlinked, practically we cannot separate them out. But prior to 1950s, the histopathology was mainly remained to a post-mortem examination. And that time, it was obscured by autolysis, passive congestion of the tissue. And even we didn't have that time a thin section facility available. So most of the renal conditions which were picked up on autopsy were so chronic and advanced that they could not yield any information for the early stage or evolution of the disease. So that's why that time pathology was considered as an unimportant side of nephrology. So there was a lot of resistance even to consider pathology in main era. So that's why we divided it into two eras. One is 300 era, which started from 1650s when microscope was invented, up to 1950s when the microscope was started getting used in renal pathology. But till that time, almost till 1950, we lacked clear understanding of the cause of the and evolution of various renal diseases. And then 1950 onwards, the process became very fast with the introduction of renal biopsy, development of a good technique for proper tissue obtained and without any complications, development of EM and immunofluorescence facility. And that led to analysis of pathological changes in great details. We all know we are worried of accidents, but many of the time they are not accident mistakes, but they turn out to be a beautiful accident. And same thing happened about kidney biopsy. Before kidney biopsy, liver biopsy was in use for long term. And many of the time, mistakenly, they found kidney tissue during liver biopsy. Then everybody thought, why not use kidney biopsy for diagnostic purpose? But it was used only for diagnosing tumors. So it was mainly used for focal lesion. First time in 1944, Niels Alwell performed a systematic aspiration of needle needle biopsy, but he could not publish because the sad part that patient died early. So again, the biopsy fell in dustbin. Everybody was against it, and it took another almost 6 years when Paul Iverson and Claus Braun from Denmark, which are now proudly called as the inventors of renal biopsy, they performed proper kidney biopsy with aspiration technique. But it was not done the way we do presently. It was done in sitting position with the use of IV pyelography, and the needle was inserted in the kidney parenchyma under IV pyelography, and it was attached to a vacuum. An aspirate of a core renal tissue, approximately 1 to 2 centimeter, was done with it. And they performed almost 66 biopsy, and the success rate was 42 out of 66. But at least they started a process and helped in diagnosing a lot of diseases that time, like amyloidosis, diabetic nephropathy, chronic glomerulonephritis. Then came these Robert Koch and Robert Moshe at the University of Illinois. They introduced Vin Silverman cutting needle, and even they proved that prone position is better for better yield and safety. So everybody shifted from sitting position to prone position. And these are the different needles used from 1950s onward. First, we have needle with syringe, which was attached to suction machine. Then we came with Vin Silverman biopsy needle, then true cut biopsy needle, and semi-automatic biopsy needles. And now all of us are using automatic biopsy needle. But even this path was not as smooth as we think of, because FNAC, we get a small tissue, but lot of complication with that. While core biopsy needle with automatic biopsy gun, we have excellent results. Many of us have used true cut biopsy during our fellowship. Our seniors might have used even Vin Silverman, but now new generation all are using true cut biopsy needle, or sorry, automatic biopsy needle, with almost very, very, very minimal complications. And the important breakthrough was achieved by Robert Carr, because before that, the success rate of the biopsy, which was predominantly done by Vin Silverman, was very inconsistent and was dependent on operator. So a lot of failure rates, a lot of complications. But then Carr defined technique, he redefined needles and posture technique and a lot of other procedures. And not only that, he conducted proper seminars and conferences and trained physicians. Now with trained physician, it got widespread acceptance because the complications rate had drastically dropped down and yield was better. At the same time, in 1960s, immunofluorescence and electromicroscopy arrived for processing of the renal tissue. So not only procedure improved, even the yield from that tissue and the different pathology from IF and EM has improved the understanding of renal pathology. So that's why it was Robert Koch who first did systematic introduction of kidney biopsy in the nephrology group. Then to improvise further, now we have sonography and CT scan, which are used for accurately finding out the tissue from where we need to biopsy. I think most of us, we use ultrasound, which helps in real-time renal placement. There is no risk of radiation, and it is very well suited for most of the non-focal renal biopsy and even most of the focal biopsies or problems with focal tissue like tumor. CT definitely has a better resolution, and it has a better ability to localize the lesion. It will be of great help for a deep-lying lesion. But most of the time, I think most of us use sonography as a guide for locating the tissue. But again, it is dependent on nephrologist preference. There are a few other points of personal preference. Few centers use conscious sedation, few use only local anesthesia. But I think in pediatrics, particularly a smaller kid where we don't expect good cooperation, most of us are using conscious sedation. Few centers, biopsy is done by radiologist. Rest all is performed by nephrologist. Then even policy for hospitalization vary according to center to center. Some centers practice it as like a daycare procedure, while most of the centers practice it like one day hospitalization and discharge on another day. But whatever procedure we use, whatever operator we have, the success rate has significantly improved from 60 to 70% to almost more than 90%. Now, there is a picture on this slide which is showing histopathology of one renal parenchyma. Probably it is like FSGS. But what do you feel? Is it a photograph or a drawing by somebody? First prima facie, everybody will say it is a photograph of histopathology. But no, it is a drawing made by Dr. Farr. So I really doubt whether he was an artist or histopathologist, because I don't think anybody can draw such a detailed diagram where even what are the different types of cells and what are the different types of lesion was not understood by nephrologist. He draw every part of the nephron in very detail. And that time he had drawings of a lot of diseases. This was the drawing from a nephrotic syndrome, which was called that time as a nephrosis. And this is a FSGS. So that time many of the part of the kidney were still not clear. We were still not clear what is there in the mesangial cell. How do we differentiate between mesothelium and endothelium? But his drawings of a lot of diseases made us understand, and they become sort of a gold standard for initial era. And his contemporary, Dr. Volart, he described many clinical manifestation and linked with histopathological findings. So probably this was the first pair of pathologist plus clinician worked in team in Department of Pediatric Nephrology. But all great changes has to proceed through a lot of chaos. And same thing happened in this also. What happened? Everybody felt that clinical manifestation is more important than histopathological findings. The pathology meet where actually made a lot of resistance from clinicians that time. And one of them was Dr. Bright. They said it is more important to know what the kidney does than what it looks like. So supremacy of function over structure of kidney. And that's why that time renal pathology often was overlooked as an experimental pathology rather than of any use. And important work done by Konrad Pirani has made a groundbreaking clinico-pathological studies. But this also was a more of an accident. How did it happen? The chairman from his hospital gave Konrad Pirani a task of treated from kidney. But at the same time, actually he apologized Pirani for burdening him with his responsibility, because he had little confidence, or rather he was sure that his work is not going to yield any further information. But Konrad worked hard. He performed sequential biopsies. It helped in understanding evolution and resolution of diseases. But then popped up ethical issues, because a repeated biopsy, which was an invasive procedure with certain complications, so it was curtailed. But whatever serial biopsies he had done, it has given invaluable information to all of us in understanding what is the natural process of many diseases. So Konrad Pirani showed that kidney biopsy is of great use in managing these renal patients. Same time, within next 10 years, Jakob Scherb used electron microscope. Electron microscope was invented in 1930s, but its use started in somewhere in 1960s. And this has helped understanding renal glomerulus and every minute part in very detail. He resolved the fine structure of podocyte food process and diagnosed host of new diseases, not diagnosed, discovered. Before that, what was thought of a fixation artifacts in light microscopy turned out to be glomerular endothelial fenestrations and filtration slit diaphragms. There used to be a debate over existence of any cell in the mesangium, and EM confirmed they are distinct mesangial cells which lie in the mesangium. The relationship between mesangial matrix and glomerular endothelium become clear only after electron microscopy. This was another work by a great pathologist, Heptin Stahl. I think all of us who have done fellowship in pediatric nephrology has seen this book, has read this book in detail. And this was the first modern textbook of renal pathology. Heptin Stahl was a both diagnostic as well as experimental pathologist. He studied most of the diseases in very detail. He had a systemic approach systematically he classified kidney disease. He collected all our available and relevant synopsis literature at that time. He carefully organized all these diseases, and it was seasoned by his personal observation. This book has remained of very importance for generations of pathologists and nephrologists. So the important work of Heptinstall cannot be ignored. And this was the turning point in history of renal biopsy. There was a SIBA symposium in 1961. It was attended by then the most experienced renal specialist or nephrologist. That time, nephrology was not grown as a separate, a big branch. But then it was, they all appreciated that the importance of kidney biopsy is very high in managing renal disease, not only diagnosing, managing, but even follow-up of these patients. And then onward, renal biopsy became an integral part of every major center, every major renal conference. This has played a vital role in evolution of nephrology as a subspecialty to a major medical specialty. In last 25 years, now where we have there in the picture, we have seen a very cream version of his renal biopsy. We are using spring-loaded guns. We have visualization technique like sonography, fluoroscopy, and if required, sometimes CT also. That is helping us giving better tissue yield and very minimal risk for complications. So most of us are very confident that whatever might be the problem, we can biopsy it without any risk to the patient. Even fixation and processing has drastically improved. So that has given us a good histopathology findings, despite if we get some inadequate samples. Then the skill in light microscopy, immunohistochemistry, and electron microscopy has drastically improved in last few years. But what has happened? Now we are able to diagnose more diseases. The ability to diagnose kidney diseases have far outstripped our knowledge of pathogenesis. For example, we are all diagnosing C3 glomerulopathy. But what different manifestation it can cause, what are the different pathologies behind it, still we are not aware. So the diagnosis has outstripped our knowledge of pathogenesis. So just to summarize, kidney biopsy, it's an invasive procedure with potential risk. It should be done whenever required, which will help us not only in treatment, but it can also help in providing information about the disease progression and prognosis of the disease. Thank you. So after this,
I think it's a nice introduction given by Dr. Pankaj Panthali. I think we have the next two speakers. Dr. Pankaj, can you introduce them?
Yeah. Now we have Dr. Kanika Kapoor. She has done MD Pediatrics and fellowship in pediatric nephrology under IPNA. She is associate professor in pediatrics at VMMC and is also associated at Safdarjung Hospital, New Delhi. And she is working extensively in pediatric nephrology. Over to Dr. Kanika.
Thank you, Dr. Pankaj. So, I'll be talking today about renal biopsy, how the procedure is done, and when is it indicated. So many of the things we have already seen in Dr. Pankaj's talk. So renal histopathology was a milestone in nephrology. In a way, it had led to foundation stone of many of the renal diseases which were still undiscovered. It aids not only in the diagnosis, but prognosis of the disease, and to ascertain the activity of the disease, how much is the disease reversible, and also aids us to decide whether the treatment would actually help the patient or not, or it would have been futile to further treat the patient. So it results impact decisions in around 20 to 50% of the cases, depending upon the clinical setting. So the techniques, as we have seen, have evolved over the last 70 years, so too have the recommendations and practices for post-biopsy care. So the procedures have become more of a daycare procedure in low-risk cases, And most of us are now use modern biopsy techniques, smaller gauge needles, spring-loaded biopsy needles. Often these are used under real-time ultrasound guidance and rarely under CT guidance. So how this procedure is done? The procedure for renal biopsy is relatively standardized now. Still, there is a considerable variation in the way of preparation of patient across the centers and techniques which are employed according to the skill of the operator, the competency, and the resources which are present at the center. So most of the centers now have moved to real-time ultrasound guided. Though in resource-limited settings, there could be still, if the there is the skill is not there, so it could be ultrasound localized or blind biopsies, which were done initially. So what are the prerequisites for renal biopsy? So a thorough examination, reviewing the history and investigations are imperative to decrease the post-biopsy complications. One should inform the parents or caregivers about the risk involved in the biopsy depending upon the clinical setting and in detail about the procedure, how it will be done. So most of us do, because younger children are not cooperative, less than 12 years, so we do under conscious sedation. So it is very important to analyze whether this patient would be able to tolerate the procedure. So hemoglobin is about more than 8 grams per deciliter is required. Platelet count should be more than 1 lakh. Prothrombin time should be done, and INR should be less than 1.5. Bleeding time should be done if blood urea nitrogen is more than 56 milligram per deciliter, because platelet dysfunction can happen in uremic patients. So there can be a prolonged bleeding time and increases the bleeding risk post biopsy. So serum creatinine should be done and eGFR should be estimated. Ultrasonography prior to biopsy should be done to know about if there are any congenital anomalies of kidney and urinary tract, if there is a hydronephrosis, if it is an ectopic kidney, if it is a small shrunken kidney, because these are relative contraindications to perform the renal biopsy. So the biopsy site should be inspected for any superficial infections, and the blood pressure should be controlled and should be less than 95th centile. So two normal size unscarred kidneys, unobstructed kidneys is what is required for a renal biopsy. So any drugs like aspirin, which can predispose the patients for bleeding, should be discontinued 7 days before. Warfarin, if the patient is on, should be stopped 48 hours before the procedure. Subcutaneous low molecular weight heparin should be stopped 24 hours before the procedure. If the patient is undergoing hemodialysis, then the procedure should be taken 24 hours of the last dialysis session. So it is good to have a checklist before the renal biopsy. This is adapted from my training center, which was St. John's Medical College, in which we used to, we also continue at our center. So a checklist is good to just minimize anything which can be missed, and to the patient is fit for biopsy. So what are the contraindications? So absolute contraindications remain uncontrolled severe hypertension, a bleeding diathesis, ectopic or a horseshoe kidney. Solitary kidney is now a relative contraindication, and many of the centers now would do a percutaneous real-time ultrasound guided biopsy even in solitary kidneys. So a multiple renal cyst is a relative contraindication. Severe hydronephrosis, active pyelonephritis on small shrunken kidneys are relative contraindications to perform a renal biopsy. So choice of biopsy method, most of the times it is the percutaneous real-time ultrasound guided. However, open biopsies may need to be done in patients who have coagulopathies in bleeding diathesis, morbidly obese patients, or a solitary kidney. So the new approach was also described, a laparoscopic and combined percutaneous kidney biopsy in children, in patients who had solitary kidney hypertension and obesity, which is an alternative to open biopsy. It is less invasive and direct visualization of kidney could be done, has been described as a safe procedure too. So the technique in native kidneys, it is the prone position. In transplanted kidneys, it is in the supine position in which the patient is positioned, so to perform the biopsy. It is performed from the lower pole of the left kidney. So the instruments now, the choice of needle is a spring-loaded automatic biopsy gun, which most of us do. So it could have a side notch or a end notch. Most of us use a side notch. So a specimen notch is there, which is roughly 1 to 1.2 centimeter in length. And so after we have loaded the gun, so it is Sure. So the instrument or the choice of needles, a semi-automated renal biopsy needle around 16 to 18 gauges, what is used in children. So the glomerular size increases from newborn at 100 micrometer to 8 years to around adult size 200 to 250 micrometer. The internal depth of 18 gauge needle is around 300 to 400, which is just more than the adult size of glomerulus. So when we obtain sections from a 16 gauge needle versus sections from an 18 gauge needle, there are more chances of getting a fragmented glomeruli from an 18 gauge needle. And the yield of a 16 gauge needle has been found in many of the studies to be more than an 18 gauge needle. So so it is advised that in younger children and infants, an 18 gauge needle may be used, but all efforts should be made to use a 16 gauge needle, though the penetration depth can vary from 1 centimeter to 1.2 centimeter, because the adult cortical thickness is around 10 mm or roughly 1 centimeter. And it is, so most of the studies have looked up at the complication rate, and it has not been found to vary between 16 gauge and 18 gauge needles, though adequacy of specimen is more with 16 gauge. So, so the procedure is relatively standardized. So IV access should be there, and the patient is asked to empty the bladder. Monitoring and resuscitation facilities should be there. So the nephrologist or the radiologist localizes the kidney by ultrasound. The overlying skin is prepared and braved in a sterile fashion. A local anesthetic is inserted, infiltrated up to the depth of the kidney, and then a 2 mm skin incision is given. So sedation with midazolam 0.1 to 0.2 milligram per kg, maximum 5 mg can be given, plus ketamine for conscious sedation can be given. So that is at the dose of 0.5 milligram per kg. If the patient is hypertensive, then ketamine should be avoided. Also in children who are infants who are very young, less than 3 months, ketamine should be avoided. So what should be the position of the needle? So once the needle is advanced, so under real-time ultrasound guidance, so the end of the needle should be correctly positioned at the renal capsule. So if there is more push to the needle, it is high chances that the needle may go through the cortex, and once it is fired, it is more likely to reach the medulla, and there is increased chances of bleeding, and also you may miss the cortical tissue. So the right side, as you can see, so the depth of the kidney is, so the needle is advanced till the capsule of the kidney, and sonographic, the distance is measured between the lower pole of the kidney and the skin, and ultrasound localization can also be done before if a real-time ultrasound guided is not being done, depending upon the competency of the operator. So there was an interesting study which was published in Canadian Association of Radiologists Journal in 2019. So most of the studies who have looked at the risk factors for bleeding have looked at mostly the patient-related factors and less about the technical-related factors. So this was a study which had looked at what are the technical factors which can affect the adequacy of the specimen and also the bleeding-related complications. So they looked at the angle of attack, that is the angle at which the biopsy needle makes with the surface of the kidney. So they, by instinct also, most of us would do a biopsy at around 60 degree angle to the surface of the kidney. So it was an evidence-based study in which they found that when they compared less than 50 degree, 50 to 70 degree and more than 70 degree, so the angle of attack which was around 60 degree, aiming at the poles and avoiding the medulla was associated with fewer inadequate biopsy and less of the bleeding complications. So after we have obtained the specimen, so it is the renal cortex, the gross appearance of the renal cortex is paler than the medulla. And you can appreciate the circular structures, which are nothing but the glomeruli. The gross the sample should be examined under a stereo microscope or a dissecting microscope for judging the adequacy of the sample, and accordingly the passes should be decided, how many passes should be done. A medulla is a more pinkish, and it has streaks of reddish streaks are there. However, the The cortex looks under the dissecting microscope with circular structures which are glomeruli. This is a wet preparation at 10 power. So how do we say that the sample is adequate? So it depends whether we are dealing with a focal disease or a diffuse disease, because if the sample is inadequate and we have taken less number of glomeruli, we will be falsely judging the disease as focal or diffuse. So at least two cores with a minimal length of 1 centimeter and diameter of at least 1.2 mm is what is said to be an adequate sample. Moreover, it is best to judge at bedside by a use of stereo microscope, and 10 to glomeruli yield is adequate for opinion for a histopathology. Even one glomeruli is sufficient for membranous. However, in FSGS, one can miss if less than 10 glomeruli are obtained. So to ideally diagnose FSGS by light microscopy, most of the studies now say that around 20 glomeruli should be there. So 2 to 3 passes are sufficient to yield tissue for light microscopy, immunofluorescence, and electron microscopy. So once we have obtained the two cores and the adequacy of the sample is ascertained, so around 2 mm of tissue is cut at each end of the cortex and the medulla, and this sample is put in the EM vial. And each from the cortex and medullary end, the half of the tissue is put in the IF vial or the Michel's media, and the other half in the light microscopy vial. So what are the fixatives? So light microscopy, high quality 10% buffered aqueous formaldehyde is used for as a fixative and transport media. Immunofluorescence, Michel's transport media, and both of them are remain stable for around week at room temperature. However, for EM, it should be refrigerated because the half-life is short, and it is 1 to 3% of glutaraldehyde, which is used in EM vials as fixative and transport media. One should always avoid cross-contamination of fixative fluids, which can interfere with the assessment of histopathology later. So clinical information remains indispensable. So histopathological forms should include the whole of the clinical and investigation of the patients, because it is indispensable to the pathologist to, you know, clinically correlate with the histopathology as well. So the post-biopsy care. So immediately post-biopsy, one should document whether there is any perineal hematoma or there is any hemorrhage which has happened at the biopsy site, or if there is any visible arteriovenous fistula. A re-scanning should also be done within 4 to 6 hours and at 12 to 24 hours after the biopsy, always including the color Doppler, as was given by the European Society of Pediatric Radiology Task Force. Which can be according to the centers if they have color Doppler, but yes, more of the studies nowadays have looked into early detection of post-biopsy complications by color Doppler. So patients should be asked to lie supine for 4 to 6 hours, because the most of the time the complications are more in the early 6 hours rather than later. Bed rest is recommended for 24 hours, and the patient should not engage into any heavy exercise, contact sports for at least 1 week. One should monitor the vitals every 30 minutes for the first 2 hours and then hourly till 6 hours. And the patient should be monitored preferably for 24 hours. So the most common complication in post-biopsy patient is of bleeding. The bleeding can happen in the collecting system when the patient presents with microscopic or a gross hematuria. A subcapsular bleeding can lead to a subcapsular hematoma, and because of the pressure tamponade, the patient can have hypertension and present with the loin pain. If the bleeding happens in the perinephric space, the patient can have a perinephric hematoma, and if it is large enough, more than 2 centimeters, hematomas can cause a fall in hematocrit. So the other notable complications which patients may have is the loin pain because of the subcapsular hematoma or a ureteral obstruction due to blood clots. There can be AV fistulas, which is a major complication, a perirenal abscess, or a pseudoaneurysm. So other complications which are very rare are need for a blood transfusion because of any hemorrhage, death of a patient, and rarely nephrectomy may be required. So this is a photograph which shows an isoecogenic collection, which is a poorly defined at the inferior pole of the kidney, which is a perirenal hematoma. So systematic review of meta-analysis of 23 observational studies was published in CJSN, in which patient they have looked at bleeding complications after a pediatric kidney biopsy. So this was analysis of around 4,188 odd patients who have undergone 5,504 odd biopsies from 1998 to 2017. And it was found that the incidence of hematoma varied between 11 to 18% when they have included the studies at different endpoints. Earlier studies and more three or four studies had more incidence of complications because of the nature of needle or by the operator skill which they had used. So excluding those studies, they found that the complicated hematoma after post biopsy was found in around 11% of the patients. Blood transfusion requirement was only 0.9%, and intervention due to complication was only 0.7%, which was required like cystoscopy, embolization, etc. So they concluded that perinephric hematoma after kidney biopsy in children is not infrequent, but requirement of blood transfusion additional interventions is significantly less common. So what are the risk factors for complications of percutaneous ultrasound guided renal biopsy in children? This was a recently published paper in which the major complication noted was again perineal hematoma in 2% of the cases, and other complications were rare. So they, when they looked at what were the, now this was a study from Taiwan. So when they looked at what were the risk factors of bleeding, they found that hypertension, low eGFR and anemia were more common in patients without complication than those in without, in a univariate analysis. However, when they conducted a logistic regression analysis, they found that eGFR less than 30 only to be an independent risk factor for major complications. And glomerulonephritis was the leading histological diagnosis in this study. So more and more studies have now shown the role of color Doppler post-biopsy in detection of early diagnosis of major complications after percutaneous renal biopsy. So what is the evidence for, so can we prevent these biopsies in these high-risk patients? So there has been advisory regarding use of desmopressin. So, but what is the evidence regarding it? So when we use desmopressin in these patients, it is at the dose of 0.3 microgram per kg subcutaneous 30 minutes prior, or 2 to 4 microgram per kg intranasal 2 hours before the procedure in children with prolonged bleeding time, that is more than 8 to 10 minutes. So this is the only randomized controlled trial which was in adults, in which they have looked at role of desmopressin in percutaneous ultrasound guided kidney biopsy in patients who had relatively preserved GFR. The GFR was more than 60 and serum creatinine was less than 1.5 milligram per deciliter. So when they administered desmopressin 0.3 microgram per kg subcutaneous versus placebo, they found that pre-biopsy desmopressin decreases the risk of bleeding and hematoma signs. But these were relatively patients who had a preserved GFR. In patients who had a high bleeding risk, this was an observational study in which they found that the bleeding complications, though they were not less, but they were similar to that of no desmopressin group. And the authors concluded that no desmopressin, yes, has a role in preventing bleeding post-biopsy in patients who have a high bleeding risk. So this is the same study in which they found that two-thirds of their patients, this was a retrospective analysis, and two-thirds of the patients who had received desmopressin had lower GFR, thus were more at risk of bleeding, have almost same incidence of hematomas post-biopsy, and also requirement of urgent radiological studies. So now it is good to have standards of renal biopsy so that individual center can monitor their own performance at the end of yearly audit or comparison of outcome of these biopsies, adequacy of sample and complications can be, you know, across centers. It could be same if the standards are same. So the British Association of Pediatric Nephrology laid down their standards in which they said that the number of passes should be less than 80%. In 80% should be less than 2 in transplant kidneys and less than 3 in native kidneys. And the adequate sample should be obtained in more than 95% of the cases, and major complication rate should be less than 5%. So this was a study conducted at our center in which we analyzed our records and of 57 native kidney biopsies, in which mean glomeruli obtained were around 17 for light microscopy, and number of needle passes were in accordance with the British Association of Pediatric Nephrology standards, and adequate tissue was also obtained in 96.5% of the cases, and SRNS was the most common indication. So major complication was very well, less than 5%, and gross hematuria, which was noted around 3.45% of the cases. So this was a nationwide pediatric renal biopsy audit, which was conducted by ISPN, which looked at if the Indian centers are in accordance with the BAPN standards. And what this survey recorded was that consent was information was given prior to biopsy 100% of the centers, but this was a recall based survey. So there is likely to be a bias regarding whether all these centers were really following the British Association of Pediatric Nephrology standards. So most of the centers were doing less than 3 passes, but notable was that adequate tissue was only obtained at 47% of the centers, and the definition of adequacy of sample varied across all of them. So only 47% would say that more than 10 glomeruli would sufficient, and many of the centers would take even lower glomeruli as adequacy of the sample. Now coming to the second part of my talk, that is, when do we need biopsy? So a biopsy is needed in patients of glomerulonephritis, nephrotic syndrome, and unremitting acute renal failure, in systemic disease to monitor the course and assess histological activity, and following renal transplantation, protocol biopsies are required to distinguish rejection, acute tubular necrosis, and drug toxicity. So there are other indications which vary according to the countries in which there are different practices. So most in adults, they won't do an asymptomatic biopsy for an asymptomatic persistent glomerular microscopic hematuria or an asymptomatic persistent tubular proteinuria. So we will look into that. So when are they indicated? So coming to the first case, Vignette, that is a 3-year-old female who had onset of nephrotic syndrome 6 months back, was treated with inadequate dose of steroids and current relapse. There was no response after 6 weeks of steroids. So is the biopsy indicated? So since the child is a late steroid resistant nephrotic syndrome, yes, the biopsy was indicated. So which revealed a focal segmental glomerulosclerosis. So what are the indications of renal biopsy in case of nephrotic syndrome? So at the onset itself, Indian Society of Pediatric Nephrology guidelines say that age of onset, if it is less than 1 year, if there is a gross hematuria, persistent microscopic hematuria, or low complements, then a biopsy should be done at onset itself. If there is a sustained hypertension, if the renal failure, which is not attributable to hypovolemia, a biopsy should be done at onset. And if you're suspecting a secondary nephrotic syndrome. So after the initial treatment, the biopsy should be done if it is a steroid-resistant nephrotic syndrome. That is, no response to steroid at 4 weeks, which now has changed to newer guidelines suggest that no response to steroid at 6 weeks, and before treatment with CNI. However, the Italian guidelines also say that more than 12 years of age also, the biopsy should be recommended in syndromic nephrotic syndrome also. Other indications remain the same. The KDIGO guidelines, however, say that decreasing kidney functions on CNI should only is when the biopsy should be indicated and not before treatment with CNI. If you are suspecting a non-minimal chain disease because of any of these factors, or late steroid resistance, that is 8 weeks, if there is no response to steroids. So what are the controversies? So persistent microscopic hematuria in an idiopathic nephrotic syndrome, so should the biopsy be done? Should all children who are more than 12 years, should the biopsy be done? And before treatment with CNIs or protocol biopsies on CNIs, should they be done at all? So this was a very good paper who looked at spectrum of adolescent onset nephrotic syndrome in Indian children, who looked at, so in this 80 patients of adolescent onset, there were 56 children who had minimal chain disease, mesangial proliferative and FSGS. Out of majority of them, 34 were steroid sensitive and 22 were steroid responders. So the authors found that biopsy would have been avoided by all circumstances in 24 of the patients. And if you combine two biochemical abnormalities, the sensitivity to have a steroid non-response was more. So the drawback was only they would have missed two membranous glomerulonephritis who did not have any clinical biochemical abnormalities. So we also conducted a study in which we looked at adolescent onset nephrotic syndrome children, in which we did 70% of the patients were biopsy, and we only biopsied those patients who had any of the abnormalities, biochemical abnormalities, or they were steroid resistant. So what are the indications of kidney biopsy in idiopathic nephrotic syndrome? What are the predictors of FSGS? So basically, our aim is always to differentiate between a minimal and a non-minimal changes. This was a paper which only looked at what are the predictors of FSGS and not other diseases. So they found that steroid resistance after 6 weeks of therapy and nephritis as initial presentation is an accurate predictor. Though we in India do not no more conduct biopsies in frequent relapsers of steroid-dependent cohorts unless we are doing a baseline biopsy before CNIs, but many of the centers across the world still continue to do this. But this paper is an eye-opener to say that it was a poor predictor and it had very low sensitivity and specificity to predict FSGS. So the other controversy was that whether microscopic hematuria at onset itself should in idiopathic nephrotic syndrome should at all be a criteria. So if it is associated with hypertension or any other abnormalities, yes, then microscopic hematuria is what when we do the biopsies, but not alone. But this was an interesting paper in which it looked at minimal chain disease and a non-minimal chain disease, whether presence of microscopic hematuria or what is the cutoff which would predict a non-minimal chain disease. And the authors obtained the receiver operative characteristics and found the optimal cutoff range was 30 to 49 in nephrotic syndrome to differentiate between a minimal change and a non-minimal chain disease for as a criteria for renal biopsy. So to answer the other controversy, whether protocol biopsies should be done, so what are the predictors? So the CNI toxicity varies between 3.8% at 1 year to 12 to 14 months. It increases to 15.4 to 16.7% on histopathology. So this was a paper which was published by Ames, in which they found that around one in four biopsies or 25% of the patients had toxicity at end of 2 years. So the mean duration of follow-up when they did the biopsies was around 30 months, and this was in 40 patients, and 10 of the patients had already had histopathology like interstitial fibrosis, striped interstitial fibrosis, tubular atrophy, and nodular hydranosis when they did the biopsy. And they found that when they found the risk factors which were associated with toxicity were initial resistance, duration of heavy proteinuria, and hypertension during therapy. However, they found no difference between cyclosporin and tacrolimus when it was given or with minimal chain disease and FSGS. So we would still do renal biopsies in children who have received CNIs more than 2 to 3 years. The second case was the 13-year-old boy who was referred for evaluation for urine analysis, which revealed 30 RBCs per hyperplasia. And the repeat urine analysis at our center revealed 50 to 60 RBCs, 40% of which was dysmorphic, and the patient also had nephrotic range proteinuria. There was history of 1 to 2 episodes of gross hematuria after a non-specific viral illness when he was 5 years old with subsided on his own. Recently, his elder brother had expired because of CKD, but he did not receive any form of renal replacement therapy. The child was found to be hypertensive, eGFR was 54, the C3s were normal. The spot urinary creatinine ratio was around 3.8, and 24-hour urinary protein was in nephrotic range, ultrasound KUV was normal. So is the biopsy indicated? Yes, of course. And the biopsy revealed 5 to 20 sclerose glomeruli on light microscopy and normal in and IF was normal, and electron microscopy was suggestive of splitting and laminations of glomerular basement membrane. So a diagnosis of Alport syndrome was given. So what is the role of electron microscopy in nephrotic syndrome? So though in the survey which was done across the centers, in which 30 centers were recruited by Dr. Rajiv Sinha, in which they found only 13% of the centers were having access to electron microscopy. But electron microscopy is required in nephrotic syndrome, especially to confirm the diagnosis of minimal chain disease. Many times we come across a biopsy which is an unsampled FSGS. So when the sample is not adequate enough on light microscopy to detect, so EM would help in confirming whether it is a minimal chain disease or FSGS. to differentiate between a primary and a secondary FSGS, to in cases of diagnosis of early membranous nephropathy, and in to confirm dense deposit disease or a membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis, and in Alport syndrome. Sometimes the light microscopy in early phase of Alport syndrome would be absolutely normal, and only findings on EM would reveal disturbances of basement membrane. So what are the other indications? So so that is glomerular hematuria. So this was a study which was published in Clinical Experimental Nephrology, who looked at 95 children with gross or microscopic hematuria. So the other debate is whether we should do biopsies in patients who only have microscopic hematuria, isolated glomerular microscopic hematuria, preserved EGFRs, and there is no renal dysfunction, there is no proteinuria. So whether biopsy should be done. So mostly in these patients, we come across histopathology which reveals Alport syndrome, thin basement membrane disease, or IgA nephropathy. And we know there is no definitive treatment for all three of them, and only you can decrease the proteinuria because of many of the agents, and none have, even glucocorticoids, none have found to be very effective in case of IgA nephropathy. And it is only the evidence is in favor of ACE inhibitors, which retard the progression. But usually it is initiated only when proteinuria sets in. So whether we should at all do a biopsy in patients who only present with glomerular hematuria is controversial. So this study looked at the predictors of favorable and unfavorable outcome in these patients, and they found that persistent proteinuria and baseline EGFR was lower in patients with unfavorable outcome, and it, it was statistically significant. So this was this adds to the evidence that in like in US they won't do a biopsy in adults for patients who have, and they would just keep on monitoring for progression of proteinuria or patients who are progressing deranged renal functions and then do a biopsy. However, it would vary across other countries like Japan. So again, another controversy is whether we should do for an isolated non-nephrotic proteinuria and when. So this was a study which looked at how do we differentiate, at what cutoff should be optimal for differentiating minor glomerular abnormalities with others. So when we do a biopsy for isolated non-nephrotic proteinuria, we end up either it is a normal biopsy, or we end up getting an FSGS or a mesangioproliferative or rarely a membranous nephropathy. So this study, they gave... which was published in Nephrology Dialysis Transplantation 2012, they found that the receiver operating curve, when they obtained it, they found the criteria in children with asymptomatic constant isolated proteinuria, the cutoff, optimal cutoff was more than 0.5 gram per gram, and adults, they would take around 0.5 gram per day as a cutoff to do a renal biopsy in patients with isolated proteinuria. So coming to our last case, 8-year-old male who presents with progressively increasing edema, gross hematuria, oliguria for 20 days. The child was hypertensive and had anasarca, revealed microscopic hematuria and nephrotic range proteinuria. The albumins were low, the cholesterol was high, and the patient continued to have worsening of serum creatinine. The C3s were found to be normal. ASO titers were normal. ANA and C-ANCA-PANCA was normal. So is the biopsy indicated? Yes. The patient was planned for pulse methylprednisolone for 3 days, and the provisional diagnosis of rapid progressive glomerulonephritis was done, and the biopsy was done, which revealed 11 glomeruli enlarged, hypercellular and lobular accentuation was there, and there was tubules showed focal injury in the form of lowering of epithelium. So it was actually a diffuse proliferative GN, and IF also revealed IgG 2 plus along the peripheral capillary walls, and IgM C1q were absent. So it was an immune complex mediated with an acute tubular injury. Probably the renal functions were more deranged because of the acute tubular injury rather than because of the any other histopathology per se. And then initially we gave immunosuppressive, which was later withdrawn because the patient recovered and is kept in follow-up and is doing fine. So what are the indications of doing a renal biopsy? We won't do a renal biopsy for a PSGN case, but yes, if there is a lack of serological evidence of streptococcal infection and the C3s are normal, if you have any other systemic features like joint pains and rash, if the patient is having rapidly progressive glomerulonephritis, there is a delayed resolution of PSGN. So a biopsy is warranted to see whether if the patient is having a crescentic GN or the patient is actually a non-PSGN, if persistently low C3 levels are there more than 12 weeks, a patient could be a membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis presenting as a, initially wrongly diagnosed as a PSGN. So what are the other indications? So other indications remain acute unremitting AKI more than 2 to 3 weeks to assess the extent of tubular injury and helps us in prognosticating the patient, is useful in diagnosing a crazed crescentic GN, and also in diagnosis of acute interstitial nephritis, in which we can give steroids. So if the etiology of renal failure is not identified, in systemic diseases, to monitor the course and assess the histological activity, a renal biopsy may be required. So to sum up, real-time ultrasound-guided percutaneous renal biopsies rather than blind approach is what is recommended. Semi-automated spring-loaded guns, 18-gauge in infants and 16-gauge in older children is preferred. At least 2 cores should be obtained and not more than 3 passes should be done. Use of bedside microscope to assess the adequacy of sample is established to minimize the passes. And monitoring closely for 6 to 8 hours in low-risk patients and 24 hours in high-risk cases, what is required. Renal insufficiency and poorly controlled hypertension increase the risk of post-biopsy. In patients with renal insufficiency, desmopressin should be given prior to biopsy. And it is important to lay down standards, local standards, to keep auditing the outcomes of renal biopsy and to assess the adequacy of renal biopsies for diagnostic purposes and so that we can minimize the complication rate. Thank you for your kind attention. I would acknowledge the slides of the biopsy which were given by Dr. who is a professor of pathology.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Kanika, for such an elaborate and complete information about procedure as well as indications. Because many of the time we find the we don't find clear-cut indications for biopsy, and that leaves a lot of gray area whether we should biopsy or follow up this child. But your talk has made it very clear when we should hold ourselves from taking gun in our hand and when we should be very aggressive and shoot the gun immediately. Now, our next talk, Kanika has done biopsy. Now, it is the role of Dr. Chandra Mauleshwari to interpret it. We all have done according to indication, but again, what it comes out to be from the report will be dependent on Dr. Chandra Mauleshwari. Just a minute. She has done fellowship in nephropathology with special interest. She is a senior consultant at Madras Medical Mission at Chennai, and her special academic interest is oncopathology and nephropathology. She has been awarded by many awards like Best Doctor Award from Government of Tamil Nadu for the year of 2019. Now, Dr. Chandra Mauleshwari now will present us with how do we understand histopathology of kidney. Madam, over to you.
Dr. Pankaj, we'll just wait for Dr. Chandra for a few more minutes. If not, we'll just take up questions for Dr. Kanika.
Yes, sir. Yes. So we'll wait for some time before taking up questions, or shall I?
Like, there is one question in the chat box you can just read out for her. You're able to see the question? There is only one question. You can just scroll the whole page down. You can scroll the whole page down.
Yeah.
It is there.
Dr. Kanika? Yeah. It's not completely displayed. Okay. Hello. Dr. Kanika?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm there.
So there's a question where child has received Endoxan, but again relapsed after 1 month of stoppage of Endoxan. What to do next? So do you recommend biopsy at this point, or you would like to use something else?
So if the course of patient was, if we are deciding to use CNIs, yes, most of the centers still we do, and at our center also, we do a pre-CNI biopsy to look at, the baseline histopathology. So sometimes we do get FSGS in these patients who have initially responded to steroids and were steroid dependent. But we do a renal biopsy to look at, because CNIs, they are nephrotoxic. So just to keep it safe, a baseline biopsy is done to look at the histopathology. Though if we are deciding to use a CNI, I would do a biopsy. But if I am moving to give MMF or rituximab, so I won't do a biopsy. So if I'm using a CNI like cyclosporine and tacrolimus, yes, I would do a biopsy.
Another question. Why GFR estimation is a prerequisite for biopsy?
So, like I had shown in the slide that, the studies have looked at when the eGFR, so in adults, there is data if the serum creatinine is more than 2 mg/dL. And if the patient is uremic, there is a lot of platelet dysfunction and there is increased chances of bleeding in these patients. So if we do an eGFR estimation and the eGFR is less than 60, so there is high chances that this patient can bleed and have perineal hematoma and the course can be morbid later on. So definitely we do not want to harm the patient. So we would do an eGFR and we would get a, that could be, then we give a desmopressin prior to a biopsy. It can be subcutaneous or it can be intranasal depending upon the availability. So 0.3 mcg/kg subcutaneous is what is advised if the patients are having a low eGFR. And also post biopsy, you would like to keep these patients for extended monitoring. However, in patients who do not have a low eGFR, you can do it as a daycare procedure and you can discharge the patient after 8 hours of biopsy. But in patients who have delayed renal function, you would keep the patient and you would be more vigilant about the complications.
Dr. Kanika, do you keep any creatinine value cutoff before considering biopsy?
Depending upon what is the indication, like most of us would do a biopsy in case of rapid progressive glomerulonephritis because the biopsy is urgently indicated in mostly in patients who, because you cannot wait and it is a renal emergency, you would give methylprednisolone pulses also. But there is no cutoff which I came across and we do not do it. But yes, uremia and if the serum creatinines are more than 2 mg/dL, if the urea is more than 100, and if the patient is having other symptoms as well, you can dialyze the patient first and then do a biopsy. Or if the serum creatinines are lower, you can give desmopressin. And if the ureas are around 100, you can give desmopressin and do safely do a biopsy.
So do you recommend intranasal desmopressin or only subcutaneous desmopressin?
So we have been giving intranasal desmopressin also around the 2 to 4 microgram per kg. So because and that has been found to be equally safer than, but there is no head-to-head studies or evidence-based studies which have looked at subcutaneous versus nasal desmopressin. I didn't come across that data, but yes, we have given intranasal desmopressin in our patients.
In your center, you follow subcutaneous desmopressin, is it?
Sorry?
In your center, do you follow subcutaneous desmopressin?
No, we follow intranasal.
And so I just have my own question. Like prior to initiating a child on mycophenolate, do you biopsy a child if it is a steroid dependent?
No. We would only do biopsies in a steroid dependent if the patient is being planned for CNI. We never do a biopsy for mycophenolate. No.
Okay, for rituximab?
No.
No, even for rituximab, you don't biopsy.
Mostly our patients who go on rituximab are those who have already failed CNI.
Okay, you'll be having a prior biopsy prior to the CNI NCs.
Yeah, these are the patients who continue to be bad relapsers who on CNI. So we still use rituximab as our last resort because of the availability constraints and because the setting in which we are working.
So there was one more question, but I think you already answered that question. How soon to give rituximab after recent endoxan? Worried about over immunosuppression. I think most of us won't jump immediately to rituximab after endoxan. We have mycophenolate and CNIs in between. So using rituximab will be always with precaution. Yesterday only Sir said very well in ISPM conference, because initially rituximab came with big bang, but there are a lot of problems with that also. So let us not jump to rituximab immediately after cyclophosphamide.
And there is a prolonged immunosuppression, lot of viral infections, and these patients can land up into severe sepsis.
Actually, some practical issue, like electron microscopy is not available at many of places, even at the place where I practice. From here, I have to send to something like Hyderabad or quite far away. So how shall we transport it? Like simple thing for Alperts, we can't prove or disprove unless we have EM in our hand. So many of the time we have to resort to genetic testing because transportation is also a big issue. So any call on that?
It has to be transported, it has a very short half-life, so it has to be transported either you have in the ice packs, and because the shelf life of that glutaraldehyde is very less. I don't know if it varies from centers. Here we send biopsies to a local, I usually send to GB Panth Hospital. So we transport within an hour or so. So that's not an issue for us, but I think we can ask Madam regarding how we can transport in case we don't have nearby health facility.
And as we follow up, these are the questions from my rather than any other delegates. Now we follow up USG and Doppler with every patient after biopsy. Is there any role of following up urine routine also for hematuria or microscopy?
We don't do that. Now we don't do that. Though when we were trained, we were told to collect samples, six vials we used to give. But microscopic hematuria, many of these patients will have some of the studies, there have been so variable results. Some of the studies have reported 100% patients as having microscopic, some as 40%, some even lesser 15%. So I don't know what cutoff criteria have been taken across studies. But we only look for gross hematuria, and yes, we routinely do a check ultrasound within 4 hours. So that's our practice. So we do a check ultrasound. So it may not be a color Doppler because most of the times it is not available post routine hours. So we do a normal ultrasound within 4 hours or 6 hours of biopsy to look for perirenal hematoma.
And as you have suggested, horseshoe will be a contraindication for percutaneous biopsy. So what do you recommend for that?
So all these congenital anomalies of kidney and urinary tract, because can have aberrant vessels or the vessels may be, so extensive evaluation after that also may be required. So maybe CT guided, or many of the studies have looked into laparoscopic or open biopsies in these patients. Because the anatomy can be very much so, there are high chances you can hit a major vessel.
Yeah, so probably laparoscopy will be of help because even the position of horseshoe kidney is quite abnormal. It will be difficult to hit from there.
Yeah.
Now with the advent of genetic testing for Alperts, can we avoid biopsy and straight away for whenever we are suspecting strongly Alperts? Can we consider genetic test in that?
Yes, if there is a family history, you can, but prognosis, I don't know. So depending upon what is the progression of kidney disease, won't come to know. So if the parents really want to know what is the prognosis and how much already damage has happened, it won't change the diagnosis, and you would only monitor the proteinuria's. So we can. So if there is a strong suspicion is there of alcohol. Even skin biopsies have been done at many of the centers, but sometimes you do not get that positive stain for those antigens, alpha 4, alpha 5. So sometimes skin biopsies may be negative. Sometimes if they are positive, you can you may not do a renal biopsy in those
renal
patients.
Biopsy.
So
that,
yeah.
I think madam is not able to join. We'll just wait.
Yeah.
There are a few more questions in the question section. Dr. Pankaj, can you read out the questions for Dr. Kanika? Dr. Aarti, she wants to know the continuity of the second question. The second part of the question needs to be answered from Dr. by Kanika. There was a second question asking for 7 years old child with a steroid dependent nephrotic syndrome, given 12 weeks of endoxone, child readmitted but again relapsed within 1 month of stoppage of endoxone. So what to do next?
Yeah, we had that one question first. That first question was that.
She was asked again for the second half.
So she wants to know what other immunosuppressants she would like to consider. So since the child is a 7-year-old, and what we would like to know what has been the course before. So whether the child was high dose dependent steroids. So mycophenolate would be a good choice in these patients. So you can go for mycophenolate mofetil at a dose of 600 to. So mostly we start around 750 to 800 milligram per meter square per day in 2 divided doses. That could be a good option in this child who is relapsing soon after endoxone. So, but if the patient continues to be a bad relapser, because endoxone is a very good immunosuppressive. So I doubt that the patient, but you can see the course. If the patient continues to relapse or there are two close relapses on a mycophenolate, you would do a biopsy and start the patient on CNI.
And the use of levomisol, another question.
Use of levomisol in patients who have high dose dependence, who have failed endoxone, I won't do it, because levomisol has been found to be a mild steroid sparing agent. It does well in less dependent toxicities there, low dose dependents, and who are not very toxic, who did not have any bad relapses, and who are just frequent relapses. So in that, levomisol has been found to be doing good, but not in patients who have high dose dependence. So I think your patient is a high dose dependent steroids who has even failed endoxone. So I would not try levomisol in that patient. I would go for mycophenolate or a CNI. That would be a physician's discretion.
Any other questions for Dr. Kanika?
Actually, her presentation was too good. She has covered almost every point with a lot of scientific support. So I don't think it has left any question about biopsy. All the questions are for immunosuppressants rather than the procedure.
That's true. That's very true. I think we'll just wait for 5 more minutes. In case if madam is not able to join, then we'll close the session. We'll just wait for the questions also to come, because usually we close up the session a little late. Probably we will just wait for 5 more minutes. In case if madam is unable to join, then we'll close the session with the questions. I think there is one more question for Dr. Kanika.
Yeah.
Dr. Pankaj, you can read out the question for Dr. Kanika.
Yes. Infection-related glomerulonephritis in a child. Do you ever give steroids? In adults, often they need short course of steroids even after resolution of infection. If crescents on biopsy, etc. So basically, they want to know, shall we give steroid in infection-related glomerulonephritis, which is practiced in few of the adult centers? And another is, if crescents on biopsy.
So the cutoff which has been given in some of our textbooks and in studies which has been found infection-related PSGN, if it is more than 30% of the crescents are there, though crescentic GN we say as more than 50%, but cutoff to use immunosuppressants like steroids, they're given if more than 30% of crescents are there. So steroids may be warranted. And if it is a non-resolving GN, you would obviously do a biopsy and found. So like in our patient also, we did give initially methylprednisolone pulses, but by the time we found that it was a diffuse proliferative and a receding GN, and the patient was having more of ATN, we stopped immunosuppressors. So if it is a non-resolving GN, you would do a biopsy to find out, but not in all infection-related GN we would give. Unless there are crescents. A crescentic GN would warrant immunosuppressive therapy in form of methylprednisolone pulses for 3 days and IV cyclophosphamide and followed by oral steroids would be required, but not in non-crescentic we would not give. Crescentic we would give. I can comment here.
Ma'am, are you able to hear me?
It's audible. The thing is, like, we'll operate the slides for you. You're very much audible. I think keep the external disturbances away from you.
All right. Okay. So Dr. Kanika has been highlighting the importance of renal biopsies and the indications so far. So me being the pathologist, I will just highlight what are the things as a pathologist I'm supposed to keep on looking in a renal biopsy. So this is what it is. So renal biopsies, once we get it in the laboratory, we are supposed to make a specific diagnosis and point out at the differential diagnosis and then assess the prognosis of the patient with assessment of the chronicity and then choice of therapy and monitoring its progress is what we generally do as pathologists. So these are all the jobs of the pathologist. So in diagnosing a renal biopsy, pattern recognition is very, very important. Pathologists are supposed to recognize the pattern of pathology over there. And it is very, very important for us to always remember that single pattern can be produced by multiple diseases. For example, a diffuse proliferative glomerulonephritis, if you see as a pattern on HND under a light microscope, you are supposed to think of multivarious pathological mechanisms, including infection-related glomerulonephritis, SLE, and other systemic diseases and other pathologies as well. So likewise, like how one single pattern can be produced in various diseases, one single disease process, one systemic disease process can also produce multivarious patterns on histopathology under the light microscope, which has to also be remembered while you are evaluating the light microscopic slide section in a histopathology. So correlation between clinical findings and laboratory values and biopsy findings becomes very, very imperative, as Dr. Kanika already pointed out in her session. So without clinical findings, just looking at a light microscopic picture or an immunofluorescence finding is definitely going to be valueless and worthless. So it is always a combination of clinical findings, laboratory values, and the biopsy becomes handy in making a specific diagnosis. So the diagnosis arising out of a renal biopsy is considered as such as a clinico-pathological issue. The timing of biopsy is in the late stages of a progressive disease. So in case you happen to see look at a renal biopsy under a light microscope, you see only chronicity. If it is a progressive disease and the biopsy is done at a late stage of a progressive disease, You just happen to see the chronicity. Only the sclerosigmoidi, only the atrophic tubules, and only the interstitium, which is expanded because of the tubular, I mean, interstitial fibrosis and tubular atrophy has progressed, and because of that, you do not actually come across, and you are not actually able to identify the initial pathological process which caused this progressive disease, and finally gave rise to this end-stage renal disease. So, in advanced cases, examination of the most preserved areas in the biopsy section becomes imperative, and it is always advantageous for a biopsy procedure to be carried out as early as possible in a disease process once there is an indication, if you really want to pinpoint what is the initial disease process which has progressed into end stage DSM. So first I will start discussing a few cases to make the lecture interesting. So these are a few cases which you commonly come across in the pediatric age group. And of course, I have chosen 4 cases, out of which 3 cases are applicable to the pediatric age group. And 1 case, of course, is not at all applicable to pediatric age group. But I happen to choose this case also because Dr. Kalaiwani made a mention that amyloidosis would be interesting for a discussion. So in spite of, or rather ignoring the age of the patient, I have taken the 4th case also into consideration. So let us start one by one. So this is case number 1. So this is an 8-year-old female with a history of red colored urine and hypertension. We have 50 serum creatinine was 2.5 and serum albumin was 3.1. So on urine routine examination, urine showed 2+ protein, RBCs were 10 to 15 in number, and WBCs were 10 to 15 in number. So this was the picture we came across under the microscopy section. So you can see in this PowerPoint presentation that there are 2 pictures. So the right-hand side shows the picture of the glomerulus on H&D, and the left-hand side shows the picture of the glomerulus on H&D, and the right-hand side shows the picture of the glomerulus on JMS, so Jones, Methenamine, and Silver. So just concentrate on this case specifically, and later on I will tell you the stains which are routinely in use in our laboratory for diagnostic modalities. So this is the picture which shows a single glomerulus, and you can see that this portion of the glomerulus is compressed to one side by a proliferation. This is called as an extracapillary proliferation. You can see the glomerular capillary loops over here, which are compressed towards the left-hand side of the Bowman's capsule. So this is the Bowman's capsule, and this is the compressed glomerular capillary loop. And you can see that there is an extracapillary proliferation. It's called as a crescent, cellular crescent. So when we are seeing a crescent, we are supposed to categorize the crescent into either a cellular crescent or a fibrocellular crescent or a fibrous crescent. The importance comes in the fact that cellular crescent is the one which is acute process. So fibrocellular crescent and cellular crescent, we give a lot of importance and we make a mention in the biopsy report, whereas a fibrous crescent is a chronic process which may not carry an equal importance like the cellular or a fibrocellular crescent. So this is the H&D picture of a cellular crescent with a compressed glomerulus over here, and the crescent, which is the extracapillary proliferation, which is filling in more than 1/3 of the capillary loop here. So this is the JMS picture. You can see the compressed glomerulus at one end here very clearly. JMS is black. The black color here in the JMS highlights the glomerular capillary basement membrane. So this is the compressed glomerular loop, and this is the cellular crescent, which is pushing the glomerular capillary loop to one side. So this is the glomerulus which is showing a cellular crescent. So this picture actually highlights another glomerulus which is showing a diffuse proliferative process. So like how Dr. Kanika also showed a picture of a diffuse proliferative process, you can see that this is a single glomerulus with a Bowman capsule, and the proliferative process causes lobular accentuation of the glomerular capillary loops. So apart from the glomerular capillary lobular accentuation, you can see that there is a lot of neutrophilic infiltration. So these are all the neutrophils which I'm able to identify here. Neutrophils you can identify by the presence of 2 lobes. Okay, so this is called as an exudative. So whenever you see a neutrophilic infiltration into the glomerulus, it is called as an exudative type of glomerulitis. So exudative diffuse proliferative type of glomerulitis, you can straight away consider even before immunofluorescence, considering the age of the patient, which is very, very young, and then the presence of hypertension, sudden onset of hematuria. Of course, the complement values were not given, which was asked later on to the consultant and found that it was low. Okay, so under the light microscopy, if you find a diffuse proliferative type of glomerulonephritis with or without cellular crescent. Cellular crescent carries a worse prognosis when compared to just a diffuse proliferative type of glomerular nephritis. Okay, so with that, our consideration, not like microscopy, was infection related glomerular nephritis for this particular age with cellular crescents. So now moving on to immunofluorescence. So this is immunofluorescent picture. What you see here is IgG on the left side and C3 on the right side. IgG, you can see that it is traced to 1 plus positivity. Our scale here, which we use in triple M, is up to 3. So 1 plus, 2 plus, 0, 1 plus, 2 plus, and 3 plus. So grading as per our scale, it is 1 plus along the capillary and some amount of staining in the mesangium. So here you can see that this is the C3 staining. C3 is brighter than IgG. This we gave a intensity of 2 plus. So when we are scoring an immunofluorescence, we always score the intensity of staining and then make a mention whether it is a granular or a linear positivity. So granular is what you see here, dot-like positivity, dot, along the glomerular capillary membrane or in the mesangium is called as a granular positivity. So this intensity was 2 plus, and then the pattern of staining was granular and not a linear positivity. And then after that, you have to describe the presence. Okay, where is the positivity present? Is it along the glomerular capillary wall or at the mesangium is also important. That has also to be mentioned in the report. So here you can see that 3 plus C3 is showing a positivity along the glomerular capillary wall as well as at the mesangium. Okay, so based on these findings of the along with the clinical history, findings, we gave a diagnosis of infection related diffuse proliferative glomerular nephritis with 2 cellular crescents. And then the commonest cause for the proliferative glomerular nephritis at this age is infection related glomerular nephritis. So electron microscopy, as Dr. Kanika was pointing out, is also becoming an integral part of the diagnosis of renal biopsy. But we don't, in our center, we don't generally do it for all cases, but for a few affordable patients, we definitely go ahead for electron microscopy studies, because it can highlight something which is unexpected and new also. So in the infection related glomerular nephritis, what you generally see is called as this case patient did go for an electron microscopy for confirmation, and this we just did it for research purposes and for record purposes. So in this case, you can see that this is a capillary loop. This is an electron microscopic picture. This is one picture and this is a second picture. Here you can see that this is a capillary basement membrane, and here you can see that this is the leukocyte. Okay, so endothelium and the leukocyte are proliferated. That is why this is supposed to be the capillary lumen. This entire space is supposed to be the capillary lumen that is occluded by endothelial proliferation as well as by neutrophilic proliferation. And this is the glomerular capillary basement membrane. And here you can see something called as the subepithelial hump. So this is the epithelium. So GBM lined on the inner aspect by the endothelium and on the outer aspect by the parietal epithelial cells. Okay, so that parietal epithelial cell, underneath the parietal epithelial cell, if you see this deposition of immune complexes, is called as a subepithelial deposit. And this deposition, see, this is the higher magnification of the subepithelial hump. So this is the epithelium which you are seeing here. This is the glomerular capillary basement membrane, and this is the immune complex deposit, which is having a characteristic picture like a hump. Okay, so this is called as a subepithelial hump, which is a characteristic picture of infection-related nephritis. So like every rule has exceptions, and this rule also does have exceptions. I'm not pointing out here. And for easy understanding, I'm just showing you the typical pictures of certain disorders which are commonly encountered in our practice. So the diagnosis which we offered in this particular patient was totally 8 number of glomeruli were there for her, out of which 2 glomeruli showed cellular crescents, and the rest of them showed diffuse proliferative glomeruli. And with the picture of C3 positivity, C3 coarse granular positivity, and the electron microscopic picture of epithelial lump, and in correlation with the clinical history, we gave a diagnosis of infection related lump. Going on to case 2, this was a 14-year-old male who presented with a generalized body swelling for 20 days. Urine PCR was 3.4, serum protein was 4.8, and urine protein was 3 plus, and serum C3 and C4 were normal. So renal biopsy was done. I'm sorry for the quality of the picture on the left hand side of the PowerPoint, but still you can appreciate that this is renal core biopsy, which is showing the cortex of the kidney. And here you can appreciate this is one glomerulus, second glomerulus, third glomerulus, and this is one portion of the glomerulus. And you can see the interspersed tubules, which are here. Okay, so this is a higher magnification of a glomerulus shown here, and you can see that these are the open glomerular capillary loops with RBCs filling inside the glomerular capillary loop, and this is the Bowman's capsule. As such, here we do not find any specific pathology. The glomerular capillary loops are pliable. The glomerular casement membrane is not thickened, comparable to that of the Bowman's capsule. And the endothelium is not hyperplastic, and it is just lining the capillary loops over here. You can see that the loops are all open and pliable, meaning there is no specific pathology in the glomerulus here. So then what is the cause for the proteinuria and what is the cause for the generalized anasarca is what we have to explain. So meaning that on light microscopy, though you don't find any specific pathology, the patient is symptomatic, he has proteinuria and he has anasarca, which needs to be explained. So what is the most possible diagnosis, or what are the probable differential diagnoses the pathologist should entertain? So this is another Meson's trichrome stain of the same glomerulus. Here again, you do not see. Actually, Meson's trichrome stain, I will show you in the later half of the lecture. It is useful actually as a poor man's electron microscope, and you can see the immune complex deposits on Meson's trichrome. If it is classically stained, if the stain is good and if the section is good, we can very well appreciate the immune complex deposits by using a Meson's trichrome stain. So that is the usage of this Meson's trichrome stain. And here again, you do not see any specific pathology in this particular glomerulus, even on Meson's trichrome stain. So this is the tubule and interstitium. Here you can see that the tubules do not show any specific pathology. They are closely packed with a back-to-back arrangement. These are the proximal convoluted tubules, which you are seeing here. And in the interstitium, you're able to see some foam cells. See, this is a collection of foam cells. This is a collection of foam cells. And here you can see that these are a few collections of foam cells. So interstitial foam cell infiltration indicates it is actually secondary to the proteinuria. And these are lipid-laden macrophages which are accumulating within the interstitium. Okay. So 14-year-old male, generalized anasarca, proteinuria, LM does not show any specific pathology. And IF did not show any immune complexes. So what are the differential diagnoses for this patient? First and foremost diagnosis here would be minimal change disease. And the second differential diagnosis would be unsampled focal segmental glomerular sclerosis. As Dr. Kanika was pointing out earlier on in the lecture, you people must remember that for a focal segmental glomerular sclerosis to be made, the number of glomeruli currently, which is supposed to be present in a biopsy, is nearing 20. Okay, so as the number of glomerulus increases, you will be able to categorically find the glomerulus which shows a focal segmental glomerular sclerosis, because the lesion here is focal. It does not involve all the glomeruli. Only a few of the glomeruli are involved. That is, less than 50% of the glomeruli are involved. The chances of you finding a focal segmental glomerular sclerosis increases with the total number of glomeruli increasing on a given renal biopsy sample. Okay, so the differential diagnosis which you can entertain here are: one is minimal change disease, and the second is focal segmental glomerular sclerosis, which of course you have no evidence here of a segmental sclerosis, but it can be present in any other portion of the kidney which has not been included in the biopsy sample. Okay, so electron microscopy. Here again, you can see that this is a glomerular capillary basement membrane. This is supposed to be the epithelial cell, parietal epithelial cell, or in other words, it can be called as a podocyte also. Here is the inner side of the, this is the lumen, capillary lumen. This is the capillary basement membrane. And here, this is the endothelial cell. And here you can see that this is a podocyte. Okay, so here the pathology in a minimal change disease is effacement of the food processes of the podocyte, which is what you are seeing here. See, here this is actually a pictorial representation of the same thing, this being the capillary basement membrane, this being the endothelium, and this being the podocyte or the parietal epithelial cell. So here food processes are supposed to be present here as an undulating membrane structure underneath the epithelial surface. But here you can see that there is a flattening of the underneath of the parietal epithelial cell, which is otherwise called as an effacement of the podocyte food processes, which is a characteristic finding in case of a minimal change disease. Focal segmental glomerular sclerosis also can have this finding, but that is a different ballgame altogether, and I'm not bringing that into the picture of discussion for today's talk. Okay. So the diagnosis made for this particular patient on the basis of the clinical history, which is anasarca proteinuria, and LM diagnosis, which did not show any pathology, IF was completely negative, and electron microscopy showed effacement of food processes, and the diagnosis made was minimal change disease. So case number 3, this is a 16-year-old female who presented with nephrotic syndrome, steroid resistant, no comorbidity, serum creatinine was 0.6, urea was 50 milligrams, sorry, it is absent here. ANA was negative, hepatitis serology was negative, urine albumin was 3+, and PCR was 6.85. So this is the LM picture. So what you see here, this is a renal cortical biopsy. You're seeing one glomerulus here. These are all the proximal convoluted tubules, and this is the distal convoluted tubule. Over here, it can be differentiated by the lining of the tubular epithelial cells. Here it is eosinophilic, has a brush border. This one will have a cuboidal appearance. This is pink in color, this is relatively blue in color. So that is how you differentiate, and that is, it is very, very important for a pathologist to get to know on this, because you can actually differentiate the cortex and the medulla by looking at the light microscopy of a renal cortical biopsy tissue itself. So that becomes very imperative that we, and it is only the cortex which becomes important for us to assess the glomerulus, and it is the corticomedullary junction which becomes very, very important for us to look for the focal segmental glomerulus sclerosis, because that pathology seems to occur or seems to be better represented in the corticomedullary junction. So the different portions of the renal core biopsy tissue also has to be determined by the pathologist when we are under the light microscope. So this is a higher magnification of the glomerulus. And you can see that in comparison to the earlier glomeruli which I showed, see, these capillary loops are highly thickened and the capillary basement membrane is highly thickened. So this can be compared with that of the Bowman's capsule. But yeah, here you can probably compare with that of Bowman's capsule. And you can appreciate that the capillary loops are rigid. Earlier on in the lecture when I showed you the minimal change disease, you could appreciate that the capillary loops had a pliable structure. It was not this thickened or rigid in appearance. So this particular picture shows that the glomerular capillary loops are thickened uniformly. Okay. So this is the Meson's trichrome. As I told you earlier on, Meson's trichrome is considered to be a poor man's electron microscope, and when we really stain it well, it can highlight the immune complexes. If you concentrate very well over here at this arrowhead, you can see something pinkish. Okay, it is the greenish basement membrane which you appreciate here, but if you concentrate a little more, you can see a pinkish red tinge over here, which is the immune complex. Okay, subepithelial immune complex, of course, it is too much for us to expect in a light microscopy, but you can see that there is an immune complex deposition, and if you imagine it is flat and can even, okay, that I will not go on now. Okay, so this is the JMS, which becomes very, very important for us to make a light microscopic diagnosis of an entity called membranous glomerulonephritis. So membranous glomerulonephritis. So here what you see is that the glomerular capillary loop is here. You are able to appreciate the capillary loop here, and you're able to see the spikes and pinholes. You can see some hair-like extensions which are emanating from the glomerular capillary here. Okay, so these are called the spikes and pinholes, which I can explain to you, but it will take a long time. So just remember for now that the spikes and pinholes, if you see on JMS, that is Jones Menemann silver stain, which is also used as a part of light microscopic examination by a pathologist. If you see the spikes and pinholes, you always think of an entity called membranous nephropathy. Okay, so membranous glomerulonephritis, it used to be called as, but now there is no inflammation, so it is now called as membranous nephropathy. So on immunofluorescence, what did we find is that IgG was granularly positive. It was showing a granular positivity, and you can see that these are the capillary loops which are well highlighted. Even on this, that the deposition is along the glomerular capillary loops, and it is granular in appearance. Okay, so granular because there are dot-like deposits. Okay, and capillary loops because you're able to trace the glomerular capillary loop. If this deposit is present in the mesangium also, apart from the glomerular capillary loops, you think of, there are certain like appearances on LM as well as on IF, which will make us differentiate between a primary and a secondary membranous nephropathy. That is, we can at least make a suggestion that it could be a secondary membranous nephropathy and not a primary membranous nephropathy. And one such finding on immunofluorescence is the deposition of granular IgG deposits in the mesangium also, along with the glomerular capillary loop. Okay, but here you're able to see the granular deposits, which are 1+ to 2+ in intensity along the glomerular capillary loop. So I told you intensity has to be described, and the pattern of staining, whether it is granular or linear, has to be described, and then the area which is stained by the immunofluorescence or the antibody deposits on either the capillary loop or in the mesangium also has to be highlighted in the report. And here in this case, in combination with the presence of edema, presence of proteinuria, the light microscopic finding of thickened glomerular capillary basement membrane, and the presence of spikes and pinholes on Jones methenamine silver, and the presence of immune complex deficits, that is IgG positivity, which is along the capillary loops, granular IgG positivity made us consider the diagnosis of membranous nephropathy. So what is the finding on electron microscopy membranous nephropathy? Here again, you can see the glomerular capillary loop, which is intact here. And this is the lumen. This is the endothelium of the glomerular capillary. See, this is the basement membrane, capillary loop basement membrane. This is the endothelium. This is the epithelial side. Okay. So here you can see that this is the parietal epithelium, which you can clearly visualize here in this picture. And underneath the epithelium, you can see the immune complex deposit. This is one deposit. And here again, this is epithelium. This is capillary basement membrane. Underneath the epithelium, you have another subepithelium deposit. So this subepithelial immune complex deposit, you can compare it with the earlier picture which I showed you for infection related glomerular nephritis, and I described that subepithelial deposit as a subepithelial hump because it was showing an elevation. Okay, so it was a hump like deposit, whereas here you can see that these are irregular deposits here and there along the subepithelial aspect of the glomerular capillary basement membrane, which is a characteristic picture in case of a membranous nephropathy. So here again, you can consider it in another electron microscopy picture, which I thought I should show it to you, because that was the previous picture was that of an earlier deposit, whereas here you are able to see that this is a capillary loop distinctly, you are able to see, and there are irregular massive deposits which are present along the glomerular capillary basement membrane, and the presence or absence of these deposits depends upon the stage or depends upon the phase of the disease in which we are biopsying the renal cortex. Okay, so that case is membranous nephropathy. So this is the fourth case which I was talking to you about. Just for interest sake, I brought it to you. This does not definitely relate to pediatric nephrology, but nephrologists, all of us definitely enjoy this look at this pathology. Though the pathology as such is bad, the picture it creates and the stains it takes up and the polarization it gives is actually really interesting for all of us to want to understand and want to know. So 52-year-old male with nephrotic range proteinuria came to the OPD actually for cardiac evaluation. So referred, cardiac evaluation was done, and because he had some GI symptoms also, he was referred to the GIED. He underwent a GI biopsy, after which he was sent to nephrology OPD to evaluate for proteins also bring him. So GI biopsy, I will tell you, already showed thickening cells. Okay, I will highlight that a little while later. Now let me talk about renal biopsy. So here is the renal biopsy picture. On the left hand side, you're able to see the PAS picture, and on the right hand side, you're able to see the JMS picture, Jones Methylamine Silver, and this is the PAS picture. Not a very good PAS, but definitely PAS, because here you're able to see the PAS positive Bowman's capsule here. All right, so PAS positive tubular basement is also here, whereas this is the intact glomerulus, and in contrast to the glomerulus which I showed you earlier on in the lecture, you are able to see that there is some mesangial deposition of a homogeneous eosinophilic refractile substance. Okay, so this homogeneous eosinophilic refractile substance is PAS negative or faintly PAS positive, you can call, in comparison to the Bowman's capsule, which is very strongly PAS positive here. Okay, so this is a pale pink structure, which is pale, like it has not taken up the PAS, or it is pale PAS positive. And here this is the JMS, and Jones Methylamine Silver, as I already told you, highlights the basement membrane. Bowman's capsule of the glomerulus is very well highlighted, and the tubular basement membrane is also very well highlighted here. And here as such, if you see this eosinophilic substance in comparison to the glomerulus here, if you see the substance actually is also pale, it is not taking up the JMS at all. Okay, so if it is taking up the methylamine silver, it has to be black in color, but because it is negative, it is showing a pale architecture, which is actually, in actuality, we can describe this as JMS negative and PAS negative. Okay, so moving on to the next slide. See, this is the Congo red stain. Okay, so left hand side, the same glomerulus using the Congo red stain. See, a PAS negative, JMS negative structure, which is expanding the mesangial nodule, which is otherwise called as nodular glomerulosclerosis, which is expanding the mesangium, negative for PAS and JMS. Do a Congo red stain, you can see that this is salmon pink in appearance. Okay, in other words, it can be called as a Congo red positive substance, which on polarizing microscopy shows this refractile architecture. So it is polarizing. Okay. So what is the diagnosis? It is anybody's guess. So this is actually amyloidosis. So this amyloidosis usually presents as proteinuria, and if it is systemic amyloidosis, it is going to affect all the systems, organ systems. Like in this particular patient, for example, it has affected the cardiovascular system as well as the gastrointestinal system. And a gastrointestinal biopsy, which was taken, also showed amyloid deposits in the vessels from the ileum through the cecum, ascending colon, transverse colon to the rectum, and in the sigmoid colon. So again, renal biopsy also was done for this particular patient to evaluate for proteinuria, and now you, as you saw in the previous pictures, it was definitely showing amyloid deposition in the mesangium of the kidney. Okay, as the amyloid deposits were also present in the vessels, but I just chose to show you the glomerulus alone and show you the various stains which take a positive for amyloidosis. So on electron microscopy, what you visualize in amyloidosis is that this is a capillary loop. And this again is another capillary loop. This is the endothelium on the inner aspect of the capillary loop. And you can see that the capillary basement membrane as well as the mesangium are expanded by fibrils. Okay, so this low power architecture shows you only the fibrils. But here the high power architecture, if you concentrate on, you're able to see the 10 to 12 nanometers which are arranged parallel to each other, which is characteristic of amyloidosis. Okay, diagnosis for this patient based on his presentation is light microscopy as well as the special stains which we applied, and on the electron microscopy is amyloidosis. And once you make a diagnosis of amyloidosis, of course, it is not enough for us to stop short with that. We have to pinpoint whether it is AL or AA amyloid. AL is a light chain associated amyloid. AA is systemic amyloidosis, which is occurring as a result of some chronic inflammatory or a debilitating process. And in this particular patient, the IF showed light chain restriction. So we made a diagnosis of AL type of amyloidosis for this particular patient. I'm sorry, I do not have the picture right now, but the diagnosis for this patient was AL amyloidosis, which is definitely has got a different line of treatment and has got its own prognostic values. Okay, so all these I think were actually discussed by Dr. Kanika Kapoor herself. Two cores of tissue at least are important, and the light microscopy is the first core of the renal biopsy goes for light microscopy, and the second core goes for immunofluorescence and electromicroscopy wherever indicated. Okay, so at least 7 glomerulus we would like to visualize, and even one single glomerulus is definitely enough for us to make a diagnosis of membranous glomerulonephritis and focal segmental glomerulosclerosis. Okay, so this also she pointed out, I think she showed you a picture of this also. This is actually under a dissecting microscope, but in practice we do not have a dissecting microscope, and we have a practice of looking at the renal cortical tissue fresh under our routine microscope itself, and we are able to look for the presence or absence of glomeruli. And these biopsies are actually being done at the nephrology OPD, and when the biopsies are being taken, the pathologist is present at the bedside to look for the adequacy of the glomeruli or the number of the glomeruli in the renal cortical core biopsy tissues which are being taken by the nephrologist. So this is redundant because it was shown by the earlier speaker. And these are the sections which we regularly cut across. 2 to 3 micron section is the ideal thickness in which the renal cortical core biopsy tissues will have to be sectioned if you really want to look at the pathology and evaluate it neatly. Okay, elaborately and neatly. This is the thickness in which the trained technician is extremely important. A dedicated technician is extremely important. And those are ones who regularly this 2 to 3 micron tissue sections, the importance of the renal cortical tissue biopsy. So these are the stains which we routinely do on a renal cortical biopsy. So one is light microscopy, the other is immunofluorescence, as I told you initially in the beginning of the lecture. So under for a light microscopic evaluation, what we do is one stain is meson strichnum. So why do we do meson strichnum? Meson strichnum indicates the extent of interstitial fibrosis and tubular artery. Here you can see that these two are the glomeruli. See, these are glomeruli, these are the tubules which are closely packed. So this is a normal appearance in the renal cortical biopsy. But in case there is interstitial fibrosis and tubular atrophy, these tubules shrink. Okay, so tubular basement membrane is thickened, and the interstitial fibrosis is indicated by the blue color which is present in between the tubules. So the extent of interstitial fibrosis and tubular atrophy can easily be assessed by using a meson strichnum stain. And another important thing which a meson strichnum stain helps us do is to find out the deposits, like as I told you in the beginning of the lecture. Stain is the hematoxylin and eosin stain, which is the bread and butter of any pathologist. So this will definitely make us assess the epithelial damage, presence of exudative lesions, presence of interstitial edema and inflammation. Interstitial edema, of course, can be confirmed. Interstitial edema and fibrosis can actually be looked at by HND, looked at when by using a light microscopy and doing a HND section, but can be confirmed using a Meson strichnum section, as I told you earlier on in the lecture. So this microscopy makes us assess the exudative lesions, edema, inflammation, either within the glomerulus or within the interstitial tissue or within the tubules. Like a presence of WBC casts within the tubular lumen can be assessed by the HND section. So this is the pyrrolic acid chip stain. This shows us, this is actually a very good stain. I like to evaluate this stain. I like to evaluate the glomerular by using this stain because it shows me the glomerular capillary thickness. And if there is any wall collapse, it is indicated. If there is a hyalinosis, there is a sclerosis, there is any mesangial expansion, where presence of protein resorption droplets will be used. So all these are very well indicated by using a PAS stain. And vessels, you can look for hyaline arteriolosclerosis. So hyaline arteriolosclerosis, where do you get? You get it in hypertension, and you get a nodular hyalinosis in CNI toxicity as well. So for assessing the vasculature, assessing the presence of any hyalinization in the vessel or the presence of nodular hyalinosis in the vessel, PAS is a very good stain, apart from evaluation of the glomerular capillaries. So JMS, as I told you, it very well highlights the crescents, and apart from that, it very well highlights the glomerular capillary basement membrane spikes and pinholes which occurs in case of membranous nephropathy. And as it was pointed out by Dr. Kanika, double contouring is one of the features of membranous proliferative glomerulonephritis, and that can be very well assessed by using the Jones method and similar. So endofluorescence microscopy, yes, it can either be brought from the OPD of the nephrologist or from the bedside of the patient after undergoing renal biopsy in either a saline soaked gauze or in a Mishan's medium. We practically use soaked gauze in our institution, and it is of course yielding us very good results. And serial sections of 3 to 4 micron thickness are cut in a cryostat, and this is a thickness for doing an immunofluorescence staining. And one important thing while thinking about immunofluorescence is that you have to always take a photograph of immunofluorescence stain in every case, because that will be the record and the slide fades over time. So these are generalized approaches on microscopy. What are you supposed to see is what I have highlighted here. Whenever you get a renal biopsy tissue, I thought I will start with the cases and go on with the evaluation of the biopsy as such. So whenever we are evaluating the biopsy, as a pathologist, we are supposed to look at not only the glomerulus, but we are supposed to concentrate on the tubules, interstitium, and the vessels also. So the glomerular pathology can secondarily give rise to tubular pathology, interstitial pathology, or a vascular pathology, and vice versa. Meaning, you have to try and understand, looking at the renal cortex, and on the whole, you are supposed to look at it. You are supposed to evaluate the 4 compartments separately, and you are also supposed to find which is the primary process and which is the secondary process of the pathology. So glomeruli, I think all of you be aware of this picture. This is a schematic representation of how a glomerulus is going to look, and this is the real picture on HND. See, in this schematic picture, you can, but this you are able to visualize the afferent arteriole and the efferent arteriole. So this is the afferent arteriole, this is the efferent arteriole, this is a tubule, and this is the Bowman's capsule. The Bowman's capsule is here, and this is a proximal glomerular tubule which is emanating from the Bowman's capsule. So these are the glomerular capillary loops which you are supposed to evaluate. So this is the real picture. You can compare it with this, and this is the mesangium. In between the glomerular capillary loops, you have the mesangium, and the mesangium is supposed to contain only 2 to 3 cells max. So beyond 2 to 3 cells in number, you call it as mesangial expansion. So this is the electron microscopic picture for you to understand the glomerular capillary basement membrane. This is the endothelium, and these are parietal epithelial cells or the podocytes. So this is the podocyte I was trying to highlight to you earlier on. When you see the minimal change disease, I told you there was an effacement of the podocyte food processes. So this is how the podocyte food processes are supposed to be present and landing up on the glomerular capillary basement membrane for a proper filtration barrier to function properly. So effacement means flattening of the food processes, which I told you in the minimal change disease, which I showed you in the minimal change disease, which are pathological process. So this is normal, and what I showed you earlier on in the lecture is so why is clinical history important? I think all of you must be aware, but just to brush up whatever you already know. So if the clinician writes in the requisition that the patient has nephrotic syndrome and proteinuria, these are all our differential diagnosis just by history only. So nephrotic syndrome, we have to either think minimal change disease. In LM, there is no specific pathology, IF is negative, and electron microscopy shows effacement of food processes. Or it could be a focal segmental glomerular sclerosis. It will be very well, very nice if we are able to demonstrate the segmental sclerosis in the light microscopic core. But in case we are not able to see the segmental sclerosis also, we are supposed to think of an unsampled FSGS also if there is no specific pathology on LM and the IF is completely negative. So earlier, membranous nephropathy is another important cause for nephrotic range proteinuria. And here you see the membrane thickening and spikes and pinholes on Jones methanum in silver. And then you see the IgG granular positivity along the capillary wall in case of membranous nephropathy. C1Q nephropathy, some of the literature is highlighted, but I am yet to see one single case of C1 nephropathy. So glomerular diseases which can present with nephritic syndrome, these are all the ones. Nephritic syndrome or rapidly progressive glomerular nephritis is written on the requisition by a clinician. We think of acute post-infectious or membranoproliferative glomerular nephritis. Disease, idiopathic nodular glomerular sclerosis, just like an uncommon presentation of this is rapidly progressive glomerular nephritis and crescenti glomerular nephritis also, which I showed you in the first case, which was showing crescent. But crescenti glomerular nephritis, there is a slight difference because we label a diagnosis of or we give a diagnosis of crescenti glomerular nephritis if more than 50% of the glomeruli in the renal core, cortical core biopsy tissue are showing. So only then we give it a crescenti glomerular nephritis. Otherwise, we just give the pathology. For example, diffuse proliferative glomerular nephritis with so many glomeruli showing cellular or fibrocellular crescents. So the label crescenti glomerular nephritis is only given if the total number of glomeruli showing crescents are exceeding more than 50% of the glomeruli in the renal cortical core biopsy tissue. So glomerular diseases which are presenting with asymptomatic or gross hematuria, we think of IgA nephropathy, which is very, very common in our setup. We have seen many cases of this. Enochalin purpura, of course, is just not a LM and IF diagnosis. It has to have its own clinical presentation. And the clinician clinico-pathological correlation also becomes very, very important in making a diagnosis of IgA purpura. Alport syndrome is one thing, and thin basement membrane nephropathy also is one thing. Dr. Kanika showed you earlier on the lecture. So apart from the glomerular pathology, I'm supposed to evaluate the tubulointerstitial diseases also. So I'm just showing you a few pictures of examples of the tubulointerstitial diseases. So this is how the normal kidney will see. This is a glomerulus. These are the tubules. So the tubules are supposed to be present in a back-to-back manner, proximal convoluted, distal convoluted tubule. So all of these are supposed to be present without any gap in between the tubules. Whereas here, if you see, this is acute tubular injury. It is called acute tubular injury nowadays. You can see that the tubules which are having a closed lumina, the lumina is almost indistinct here. But here, if you see, the lumina are expanded and the tubules are dilated with an expanded and open lumina, which indicates that it is not normal and it is a pathological process. And this indicates the presence of acute tubular injury. So dilated tubular lumina indicates acute tubular injury. Apart from the dilated tubular lumina, there are other histological evidences also which will indicate tubular injury, like the presence of regenerative epithelial cells lining the tubular lumina. Okay, so these are regular epithelial cells. If they show injury, there will be a regenerative atypia in the cells which are lining the tubules. So this is just to show you one vascular pathology. Okay, so this is the blood vessel. Here you can see that this is an arteriole which is showing it is a hypoplastic or a high arteriosclerosis, and the lumen of the arteriole, you can see that it is totally okay. So what are the where you get occlusion of the lumina? It can either occur in hypertension, in a malignant hypertension, or in a thrombotic microangiopathy. So here again, you can see a vessel which is totally occluded. And here you can see that there is an area of fibrinoid necrosis. So the presence of fibrinoid necrosis, here fibrinoid necrosis, you can see the difference in color between this area and this area. And this color indicates fibrinoid necrosis. And this can actually be well highlighted again by using a Masson's trichrome staining, which is a stain to highlight the presence of fibrinoid necrosis. There it will take up a bright red color. So bright red color on the vessel wall indicates fibrinoid necrosis. And on HND, if you see this color, this is the entire vessel. And if you see this picture, histological appearance, and if you see occlusion of the vessel, you have to consider the pathology of a thrombotic microangiopathy. And you can confirm by, of course, with the clinical history and by using special stains like Masson's trichrome stain. So the messages, of course, this is only bird's eye view. There is much more for discussion, but time will definitely not permit us to go on and on about one each and every specific individual disease. But I think I have just given you an overview of what we generally as pathologists do after the biopsy is done. So the take-home messages are: clinico-pathological interaction is key to diagnosis, morphological pattern recognition is the foremost thing, followed by application of ancillary techniques like immunofluorescence and electron microscopy. And of course, the genetic studies are picking up very, very fast. So all of them in conglomerate will make us definitely make a great diagnosis and help the patient in getting there. So that's references. Of course, I need to acknowledge Google and the GLOMCON conferences, and of course, Hepton Stahl's pathology for the presentation. Thank you so much.
Thank you, madam, for such an excellent presentation. Those images, which sometimes look more of a drawing for us, you have made us simple to understand. Okay.
Yes.
There are a few questions from me also. Like, one of the most important problem for us who are practicing in periphery is transfer of sample, particularly for electron microscopy. So what do you suggest if I want to transfer sample for a higher center, which takes almost 12 hours from me to transfer? What should be the transport medium? Hello?
Chandra, madam, you are there? Dr. Chandra, you are there online? I think madam is not there. I think we'll close the session because we are already too late.
Already yes.
Thank you so much, Dr. Pankaj. Thank you so much, Dr. Kanika. Indeed, it was there a lot of technical glitches, but we went through it. It was worth the wait, learning histologies. Thank you, Dr. Kanika. Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Pankaj Bansali. Thank you so much. Good night. Sorry, we are so late. Bye bye. Good night.
Good night.